Hi. This is another film where I copy something that somebody much cuter than me already did. I'm going to try to show some of the books that I have on my shelf. I don't have a lot of books, but I have enough that instead of showing all of them to the camera, I think what I'll do is concentrate on those which I probably won't give away, like books that I want to keep. So I'm going to do that. 10's up, Collins. My friend Paniani just gave me this book, which is called The General Rule. And it seems to be a history of weights and measures and things like that. And I only just opened it. I didn't really have a look. I didn't read the thing yet. Looks kind of complicated, but anyway, it's pretty complete. And she bought it for me when she was visiting here recently. Here's a book that I really enjoyed. It's by Jay Atkinson, and it's called City in Amber. I try to hold it not like that, but like this. City in Amber, it's a book by Jay Atkinson, a sort of historical novel that takes place in Lawrence, Massachusetts, where I was born. And I have to say, I think Jay did a nice job with this. These old mill buildings are a motif of my childhood. I remember seeing them and like being kind of impressed, but also wanting to get the hell out of there. There's a picture of Jay. He looks much older now, but still pretty fit, I guess. He and I were in the same English class in high school, so I was pleased that he became like a successful author, so to speak. Here, I have a book just called Eilders, and this is a book. This is a book, sort of an autobiography of John Eilders, who started the bar called Eilders back in 1941, at the end of 1941. And the bar is on the Court der Leidsdorfstraat. It's a famously kind of artistic, poetic bar. Very early on, it became a kind of anti-Nazi hangout for people that. Like, for example, artists who couldn't get exhibited anywhere else because they didn't join the Nazi art guild or whatever, they could still hang their paintings at Eilders. And they had a lot of poets there historically. They still have a lot of poets that go there. And I like to go there. It's a nice bar. And so when I got a chance, I wanted to read the book about the guy who started it. John Eilders used to actually be in the union of people that worked in the HoReCa, like waiters and things like that. And when he quit the union because it was being taken over by the Nazis, he decided to go start his own little kroeg. People had some fun in there over the years. John Eilders is long gone, of course. The people that own it now is like Patrick and I think his wife. Still a nice place to go. Now, here's a book I'm going to keep, and I only just recently got this, Live TV from the Moon. Now, you might think I should have read this before I made that video. Yeah, remember me, Moon Hoax guy? But I didn't. I actually, the guy who wrote this book, and it's very exhaustively researched about exactly the technology that they used on the different missions to do the live video. He took years to write it, and oh yeah, Dwight Stephen Bonietsky. He wrote to me and said. Yes, but there was a couple of things you forgot, and maybe and so anyway, I bought the book. It's very interesting if you're into that kind of thing. And I thought I ought to read it. So there, live TV from the moon. My friend Paniani gave me this book, which is, I think, about fruit. Owoce? Does that mean fruit? This is to help me learn Polish, one fruit at a time. So, for example, we have broszkwinia and gruszka and jabłko. Is that right? Jabłko and malina. Pomegranczka? No, pomegranča, I think. But the N has a thingy over it. Things like that. And on this side, there's vinogrona, truskava, no, truskavka, sorry, slivko. It's hard to read them upside down, too. Bad enough that I can't read Polish. But anyway, that's so that I can try to learn some Polish. And Paniani gave this to me some years ago. And she also gave me this one. Survival Polish, by which things I can say stuff like przepraszam and ile płacę, nie rozumiem, I don't understand, proszę mówić wolniej, please speak slowly. This is a book I will keep. It's called The Dachboken von Anne Frank, or The Diaries of Anne Frank. And I think I got this in 2008, no, maybe 1998 actually, on a visit to Amsterdam. Somebody had already given me the critical edition in English of The Diaries of Anne Frank. And the way it works is if there's multiple parallel versions of the same thing, they sort of print them on the same page. So version A, version B, version C would be the one they published. And the first, version A is usually her original first draft. Anyway, I had all this in English, but then I was really curious to read it as a, you know, I was already learning Dutch at the time. So I wanted to get the same thing in Dutch. So I couldn't find it in the, you know, the bookshop at the Anne Frank Museum or anything like that. So I like walked into what do you call it? The Rijksinstituut voor Oorlogsdocumentatie, the War Documentation Institute. And I went up to the desk. It was this big fancy building on the Herengracht, I think. No, Kaisersgracht. No, I think it was on the Herengracht. Oh, I can't remember now. Anyway, I walked into this big imposing building. I walked up to the desk and I tried to explain to the guy at the desk, look, I can't find the Dutch version of the critical edition of the Diaries of Anne Frank. Can you help me? And he said, well, hang on, let me run down into the basement. And he came back with this because they had a pile of them that they hadn't done anything with yet. The guy, David Barnow, who edited this, was apparently on the phone with him, telling him, yeah, there's a stack of them downstairs. So I got this for like 10 guilders or something like that, and I'm hanging on to it because it's good reference material for Anne Frank. Another nice book in Dutch. Can't see much on the outside. This is one of my favorite books, actually, my favorite stories. And they made a really good movie out of it, too. It's called The Aanslag, or the Attack, Assault, by Harry Mulisch, who just died last year. And this is a story about, well, basically, there's a little boy who lives in Harlem. One of our friends is from Harlem. He is just happens to survive an attack where his family gets killed by the Nazis in reprisal for something that the resistance did. And then as he grows up, he keeps encountering people from that moment in his life. In the 1980s, they made a movie out of this book, which I thought was actually quite well done by Fons Rademakers. So this is the Anslag by Harry Mulisch. I think Harry Mulisch lived in Amsterdam, actually, but he just died last year. What's this? There's something stuck in there. Oh, it's a sticker from the Cave. Rock Club the Cave. Look. Rock Club the Cave. That's one of my hangouts. Now let's see. I think this is an interesting little book. It's kind of fallen apart. It's called The Borrel is Scarce and Kaal Geworden. Meaning the drink has become kind of bare, I guess you could say. And it's a story about, kind of almost an academic paper about how things changed during the war in the bar and restaurant business in Amsterdam and how they got through it. A lot of photos, kind of cool. Verduistering en ander ongemak. Like when you had to put blackout curtains in your windows and all the, you know, when you had to close, you had to close early. There was also a lot of things that you just couldn't get, like coffee, for example. And we'll see, but it's all kind of, it's one of those crumbly books that's not meant to last very long. Also, of course, there's that business where at a certain point, everybody was asked to hang a sign in the window saying, we don't want Jews in here. I don't know if you can see that. A lot of cafe owners were faced with that problem, including Eilders, who I talked about before. And yeah, it was a problem. They had riots about it in Rembrandtplein, which formed the basis of a short story that I wrote called After the Alcazar. Anyway, kind of an interesting source of information about life during the war in Amsterdam. And I'll put that here. Where's Oorlog in de Stad? Oorlog in de Stad, War in the City, another book about life during wartime in Amsterdam, occupied Amsterdam. And it's big, lots of information in there. I don't know if I've read the whole thing yet. I think I've only read parts of it because my Dutch. Actually, you can see where I'm trying to learn Dutch as I go along here. But it's an interesting book. It was written by two people, Friesel Roest and Jos Scheren. It's kind of scary to see the National Palace on the Dam with this in front of it. Because the rest of it looks the same. It's just we don't have Nazis here. Well, we don't have those Nazis here anymore. Anyway, that's an interesting book. Books that I will keep. I have an old copy of Walden by Thoreau, in which he talks about his time when he was living in that cabin. And on the back end of this book, there's his essay on the duty of civil disobedience, which has a lot of interesting thoughts in it, which I keep writing underlines under so I come back to them and think about them later on. Walden. If you have it, you usually keep it. There's another book that I probably won't give away, excuse me. Book on The Essential Gandhi, edited by Louis Fisher, I think? Yeah. This is a book of like things that Gandhi wrote and said during his lifetime. Mohandas K. Gandhi. And I actually did give this book away once, and then I had to buy it again because I really wanted it, so I bought another copy. And this is the one, I've had this since I think the mid-1990s, and I'm going to keep it. There's a lot of stuff in here from when Gandhi was writing his various newspapers during when he was in South Africa, and then when he went to, sort of became involved in the struggle for independence in India. And also just miscellaneous quotes of, you know, when people were running into him with a microphone. Gandhi's message to all men. Where's the women part? Three different volumes of what I think would be five altogether. I don't have all five of them. Of a book, a series called The Bezetting, or The Occupation, which is written by Lou de Jong. And it's actually based on a TV series that he did in the early 1960s, like And so there's a lot of things in here that come right from the TV show. It's a history of what it was like in Holland during the Nazi occupation, during the war. Not just in Holland itself, but also in like in Indonesian places. Ah. Oh. This. Okay, I got this in Sanok, Poland. It's a book of artwork by Bekshinsky. And Bekshinsky was from Sanok. And they had this book on sale at the Municipal Museum where many of his paintings are upstairs. It's almost like a Bekshinsky museum with a few other things in it. And Bekshinsky is wicked cool. And I guess I'm not the only one that likes him. But you don't hear that much about him. He's just got these sort of, I don't know what you call it, like, sort of, some of them look like spiritual science fiction, magical art. And the style of painting is actually quite extraordinary. I really can't say how he does it. Like, I remember seeing this one in person and wondering, what made him think of that, this light down here? It really looks like lightning, in a way. There's a lot of those. And they're quite large paintings, too, many of them. Well, this looks like he turned Christian there. Bekshinsky is, like, just really cool. So I'm glad I have that book. And I brought it all the way back from Sanok, where he had gone for a wedding. That's where my friend Paniani comes from. She's from Sanok, so that's why we were there. Bekshinsky. Ah, I would keep this book just as a souvenir, because this is a Webster's dictionary, which Paniani found for me in Amsterdam when I was like, Anna, I need a dictionary for this film. We were making a music video called Boo Boo A Go Go. And this book was in the film because it's actually a film about the words in a dictionary. It's like a just a song about a dictionary. So we had the main character flipping through the book. And because I like that movie, I'm one of the few people who does like it, I'm going to keep this book, I think. Anarchist Revolution by Errico Malatesta. I'm not sure I really like Malatesta or his ideas, but yeah, it's worth a read. The American Cinematographer's Manual. This is something you always wanted and sometimes couldn't afford when you were a young cameraman. It has lots of diagrams and charts for depth of field and shutter speed and filters and all kinds of things you would need to know. Angle of view for different size films and different lenses. And if you were an AC at the time, this was kind of indispensable. They even had like loading, you know, threading diagrams for all the different 35 and 16 millimeter cameras. So I'm keeping that because, just for old time's sake, the last time I actually shot film, I think, was in the year 2000. So not going to be shooting much more 35. But it's a useful, interesting book, and I'm keeping it. So there. This book is called In Kind and in Donker, A Child in the Dark. And I was actually the ghostwriter on this book when Max was originally trying to write it, because he was in hiding as a child during the war and hadn't really gone to school to learn to read as a young boy. Read and write, and his writing was actually kind of problematic. He had trouble making himself understood. So when he was trying to write the original in English, I met him on the internet and I helped him with how to say things more clearly. And then about 10 years ago, they actually had it translated into Dutch, and I went to the opening for that when they published it. It was nice. Max. And I actually took Max and his wife to dinner at the Nachtwacht. I think that was more like 2004, 2005 when that happened. The only thing I didn't like was that in his acknowledgments, he decided to call me Steve, which doesn't really help. So I think that's all the books that I think that's it. Those are the books that I think I will probably keep. Now I'm going to have a smoke. I suppose you can tune out if you want, right? Because, like, you've seen this part before.